tonight, this morning, we're going to do a little things a little bit different. I know that there's several people that are pretty much in gone for Christmas, but I'm glad that you're here this morning. And about a week ago or so, we had a talent show with the children. And so I've asked a couple of things for them to do here this morning. So I'm going to ask if you would come and set up, and let's welcome our first talent. Amen.
My name is Juan, and this is my cousin Jesus.
Hello.
And today we're going to do some magic. You ready, Jesus?
Yeah.
Let's do this.
Hold this.
Okay. Jesus. The first magic trick, I'm going to make this tissue box move with my own mind. It's going to be real.
Okay. Wow, that was really real.
That was 100% real, Jesus. It's like, it's just crazy. Okay, next magic trick. I'm going to make this taco disappear. Jesus, dang it, Jesus, that was for the magic trick. Oh my gosh. Oh, you need to stop eating things. It's for the magic trick. Oh, never mind that. Let's get to the real magic. Okay, Jesus. Now, I have three cups here. This is you, because it looks exactly like you. It's round, just like you.
Yeah, wait, what?
Okay, this is Sin. It's ugly, it's black, and no one likes it. It's just ugly. Okay, and this is Jesus Christ. He is our Lord and Savior. He's pure, he's clean, and he is better than you.
Hey. Juan, can I ask you something?
Yes, Jesus.
Is that red tea?
No, Jesus, and don't drink it.
I'm gonna drink it.
No. Okay, back to you. You know, when you were first born, you're all clean and you don't do any bad things, right? But when you do bad things, what is it called?
Sin.
You got it right for the first time. Okay, so when you sin, that sin gets poured into you, right? Wow. And now you look all ugly.
Now that looks like tea.
Are you lying? No, it don't drink it, okay? If you drink it, I'm going to get mad. So anyways, now you look all ugly. What do you do to get all that ugliness out of you?
Eat tacos.
No, Jesus! No! You ask God for forgiveness. When you ask God for forgiveness, what does he do?
Give you more tacos.
Dang, Jesus, no! You need to listen to church more instead of eating all those tacos. Oh, jeez. Anyways, ask God for forgiveness. He cleans you.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yes, I know, Jesus. And, yeah, but imagine God trying to sin. He just doesn't sin.
That's crazy.
Nope, there's nothing on his end. Okay. One more thing before we leave today. God can't just heal you, Jesus. He can clean all the sins. That's all for today, folks. Let's go.
Hey, Juan, is it time for the tacos now?
No, Jesus, no!
Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, begins the story of a baby that most of you should know. His daddy's name was Joseph, and Mary was his mom. This babe was very special. He was God's only son. Some angels came from heaven, and they began to sing to the shepherds in the fields below. A bright star lit the heavens to light the Magi's way to the baby in the manger who was born on Christmas Day. And all who gathered around him rejoiced and praised his birth, for the babe, the King, named Jesus, is our Savior here on earth.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and
the end of our talent show. That was our thing. Thank you guys, that did awesome.
Thank you, everybody. If the children are sitting with y'all, if y'all can direct them back to the back to the children's church, or they can stay with y'all, that's perfectly fine. Thank y'all. Merry Christmas. Oh, we're having a party too, so if they want to go, I forgot about the party. We're having a Christmas party, so now they want to go.
Amen. If y'all stand up with us and sing this morning, we're just going to praise the name of Jesus this morning.
Open up the heavens.
shout out into the name of Jesus this morning. We're going to proclaim joy to the world this morning. I know they played it a little bit earlier, but we're going to sing the song Joy to the World, and let's just proclaim our happiness for what the Savior has done for us.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive a king. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world.
If you can imagine, But for so many years, from the Old Testament, the end of Malachi, all the way to the Annunciation, it passed about 400 years before God would ever say anything to man. I don't know about you, but I get tired and I get frustrated when God doesn't answer me in about a week. You have 400 years where they had waited for a promise. And all of a sudden, the Bible says that an angel appears to the shepherds that were out on the field. And as I spoke to you last week, where I said that the shepherds represented people of low class, there were people that were, that really in reality, they did not want, it was like the lowest paying job anybody could ever find. The way they smelled, the way that they were not even trusted. They were out in the field. And all of a sudden, God says, you know what? See those people that are abandoned? I want to show up and let them know that they have hope. And the Bible says that they get there and begins to tell them that today. Now listen to what I'm going to say. He didn't say someday. He didn't say maybe one day. But he said today, in the city of David, the Savior, the one you've been waiting for, the one that the prophet Isaiah prophesied years ago, today's the day that you're going to see the hope being born. And you know what the Bible says? That when they heard the news, they begin to talk to one another. They said, you know what? Let's go see this thing that has happened. You see, it's a good thing when you hear that God can do a miracle or that God can do something in your life. But it's another thing when you say, you know what? I want to go and experience it. Come on. It's not just hearing what God has. It's about experiencing what God has in our life. And I think that today, to realize that we have hope, that we have a future in Jesus Christ, that He's been born, and because He's been born, you and I can worship and praise Him. We're going to sing it again, but I want you to sing it to the Lord. I want you to sing the chorus again, would you?
Oh, come, let us adore.
Come on, church.
Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ.
Sing it again. Come on. Sing it with all your heart. We've come to worship. He deserves it all. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Before you're seated, would you greet somebody and say Merry Christmas? Amen. Oh, come on now. We've come to praise Him this morning. We're so glad you're in the house of the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Amen. You may take a seat this morning. I'm glad you're here today. I know many people have left or been out of town, but I'm glad you're here today. Come celebrating the beautifulness of Christmas. As we, before we continue on, I'm going to ask the ushers if they would get ready. We're going to receive our tithe. We're going to pay our tithe and receive our offering today. But I just real quickly, tomorrow night, we have no prayer. That doesn't mean that you don't pray. You can pray with your family as you spend time Christmas. Pray with your family. Would you do that? Bless them. Man, bless your family. And Wednesday night, we won't have anything because I know there are other people that are traveling. But we won't have anything on Wednesday. Our offices will be open on Wednesday, though. And next Sunday, you don't want to miss it. Next Sunday night, like in the morning, but Sunday night, we're going to have a special service. at 10 o'clock, 10 p.m., we're going to gather together, and all of our friends of our churches of the African congregations are going to meet with us. We're going to have our Spanish, we're going to have our English. I mean, we're going to have a big old capirotada here tomorrow, next Sunday, amen? We're going to have us a Holy Ghost. We're going to sing. They're going to have their choirs. They're going to have their choirs. We're going to be singing. We're going to be, it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful time. So you do not want to miss it, amen? So I'm excited for that. I want you to go with me to Genesis, and I want to share something with you in verse, in chapter 28. In chapter 28, in starting, we're going to read verse 20, but in starting verse 10, Jacob gets to a certain place, and Jacob begins to see a vision, begins to see a dream, and in that dream, he sees a ladder where angels are ascending and descending. And all of a sudden, God begins to speak to him and says, listen, he said, I made a promise and I'm going to fulfill that promise to the people of Israel. And he begins to give the promises to the people of Israel. And as he begins to give the promise to him, Jacob makes a vow. He makes a promise. And in chapter 20, chapter 28, verse 20 says this. Then Jacob made a vow. He made a promise saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God. And this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house. And all that you give me, listen, and all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. I will pay my tithe. God, you've made a promise. Now I'm going to make a promise to you. I'm going to give you a tenth of what you give me. Come on now. God is wonderful, isn't he? I'm excited that we're able to give this morning. Would you bow your heads as we give to the Lord? Father, we come to you today thanking you because this is a very special occasion. Not only are we celebrating Christmas, the birth of our Jesus Christ, but God, we are also celebrating because we have been able to give, to carry on the good news that Jesus is still alive. I thank you so much for these wonderful people that have given. And I pray for those that are giving online. I pray that God, you would continue to bless them too. And in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Would you bless the Lord this morning? Thank you. ask a question. How many of you have put lights on the outside of your home? Anybody here? I used to do that. I don't know why I don't do it anymore. But I'm looking for an easy way out. I'm trying to find that light that shoots all those stars. I think I can get it at Walmart. Anybody know that? The reason why I say that is the beautifulness of going and driving by and you see all the lights and the beautiful lights. But I want to encourage you that beyond all the lights and beyond all the gifts and beyond everything, spend time of knowing and realizing what Christmas is really about. It's about our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may take a seat this morning. Thank you, musicians. Amen. What a privilege. What an honor. Amen. Well, thank you for clapping for me, but if that was for Jesus, I think it'd be a lot better. Amen. It'd be better. Yeah. I figured you felt that way. Amen. Well, I know that there's a lot of people that are about to travel and are traveling, but I'm glad you're here this morning. And I just want to just share a little bit of the word of the Lord of what God has placed in my heart. And I've been speaking about for all the people found in Luke chapter 2 when the angel appears to the shepherds. But before we get to that, I just begin to imagine the story of how Mary felt. You know, I can't really relate, but I begin to think about how we think about Mary, how privileged she was, and how she was able to have this child, and just so beautiful things. But I want us to back up a little bit before I get into this message, and I really want us to be realistic, ladies, or maybe I should say moms. I don't know how many of you recall when you were pregnant, but it was joyous, but I don't think it was that joyous, was it? Here's the thing. You say, well, wait a minute, what is he talking about? Well, let me just kind of think. You know, here they are. They're in Nazareth. She's pregnant. And so they have to travel about 70 miles. And they have to go to Bethlehem because at that time, Caesar Augustus had proclaimed a census. In other words, he wanted to make sure that everybody was registered to get taxed. In other words, let me just put it in a way you can understand it, the IRS. They wanted to make sure that they got taxed. So here's Mary. I can just imagine Joseph going up to her and said, honey, I know that you're about to have a baby, but we've got to take a trip. And there's no rentals available, so we're going to have to take Junior here, the donkey. And so 70 miles. Ladies, if you know it's difficult, possibly in a vehicle going to the hospital, can you imagine being uncomfortable on a donkey for 70 miles? That wasn't really something that maybe Joseph probably didn't say anything. He just said, let's get on and not say a word. And so they get there, and, you know, she turned. Now, remember, this is not in the Bible, but I'm just kind of thinking about it, you know, just thinking about it. And all of a sudden, they get to Bethlehem, and she says, honey, did you make reservations? And he said, you know, I know, no, I didn't, but we'll find a room. We'll find a room. And so they get there and they get to that place and he goes to the first hotel and, you know, he goes from, you know, the Marriott and they have no room and there's too many people. There's so many people. Listen, there's so many people. She's pregnant, has traveled 70 miles on a donkey. No AC, no heater, nothing. No radio, no XM radio or anything like that to hear the politics as they traveled. They didn't have any of that. And all of a sudden, they get there and he looks up and at the Marriott, there's no room. So he goes to the Comfort Inn and there's no room. He goes to the Holiday Express. There's no room. There's no reservation. So they end up going and says, "Honey, I know Motel 6 will have a room. If they go to the Motel 6, they don't have any. Can you imagine him coming back to Mary and saying, I'm sorry, but there's no room. But you know what? I've got friends. Let's call them up and see if we can stay at their house. There's no room. And he says, Mary, we found a room. She said, finally. It's in a manger. Good thing that Mary loved God. Amen. But listen, I'm trying to tell you this because how important this is. This is very, for us to understand that it wasn't just because we think about Mary and say, wow, she was blessed and she, you know, she bore the Son of God. But I look at her life. And the objective of the whole thing was to do the will of the Father and fulfill her purpose in life. Every single one of us we have a purpose. You are here for a reason. You are not born just to be born and to live a life and get your career and you die and that's it. God has placed you with the people around you because there is a purpose He has instilled in your life. And the purpose that He had placed in Mary's life, it was boggling to her because of the fact that how could it be that God had a plan such as this to have the Son of God? And we realize that this is something else. And if you look in Luke chapter 1, verse 38, she says something that is so awesome. Her response is this: I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said. And the angel left her. In other words, he said, may it be fulfilled. What you think that was easy for her, but I want to take you from the beginning how she got there. It's not just when God makes a promise to your life that it's going to be that easy. That when God has said something to you and says, I promise you, and people say, but God promised me. Yes, He did promise. But it's not as easy as you think because there's a process in which you and I have to go through to be able to grasp a hold of the purpose that He has so that it can be fulfilled. It's not as easy as we think, but God is with us. And if God is with us, then we can make it happen. Now, how did she come to the point of saying, may it be fulfilled? Let His will be done in my life. Now, you've got to understand that's a powerful response, but with the response, there comes a lot of things with it. Let me share them with you. There's a lot of responsibility. When you say yes to God, there's a lot of responsibility. And that's why a lot of people rather just not even get involved and they allow it to go by. But I've got news for you. When you allow it to go by, God will continue to fulfill His promise, but not through you or not through the people that let it go. I'd rather let God say, here I am, whatever you have, whatever it is, I have that responsibility. But with that powerful response, there's responsibility involved. There is risks and we're going to talk about all that. The risk that it takes. There's commitment that it takes. It takes dedication. It takes time. It takes loyalty. It takes faithfulness. It takes trust. It takes obligation, it takes investment, and it takes obedience. All these things, you put it together, when the response is, okay, let it be fulfilled in my life. That's why it's difficult. But God has a plan for all of us that God will look and oversee every fault that we have because He wants you to have and fulfill what He has in store for your life. The shepherds were insignificant and unimportant to a lot of people. They were out in the field. And I mentioned it a while ago that one of the things that he says is they too need to hear the gospel. When everybody else doesn't trust them, they too need to hear the gospel. The Magi, who were the sophisticated, those that were educated, those that were honorable and noble, they represent these people. They too need to hear the gospel of Christ. Now we come to Mary, who is the humble one. Mary and Joseph, they didn't have a lot of money. As a matter of fact, as they traveled, and the reason why they didn't have a lot of money, because of the fact that it's been told to us through Scripture that when they went to present Jesus, they went to Simeon, and they presented him two pigeons, meaning that if you go to Leviticus, it says that when the time of purification came for the woman, and when they came to dedicate, they had to bring a lamb. Mary could not even afford a lamb. So the Bible says that if you can't even afford a lamb, then bring the pigeons, bring the two pigeons. And so they did. That's what they had. She didn't have much. But we realize that God had chosen her for something special in her life. It's amazing for us to know why was she chosen. Here's how it goes, real quickly. In Luke chapter 1 and verse 28, the angel appears to her and brings greetings to her. And says this, greetings. And then there are two things that he says to her. The first thing he says, you are a chosen one. You are the favored one. Wait a minute. Here's an angel that shows up and all of a sudden he says, greetings, you're the favored one. Something's behind here. What's going on here? And then he says, God is with you. Now, I've already told you. I told you who has sinned, what the purpose. Now I'm going to tell you what's coming after that. So there are things that Mary goes through when the angel begins to speak to her and tell her the purpose that she has in life. She begins to go through three things that we all go through. That number one, she's troubled. Number two, she's afraid. And number three, she's confused. Let's go with the first one. One of the barriers is that she was troubled. In verse 28, if you go with me there to Luke chapter 1, verse 28, look what it says. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you are highly favored, and the Lord is with you. Now look at verse 29. Mary was greatly troubled at his words. In other words, it freaked her out. She began to think and say, how could it happen? You know, I'm bothered by this, that God would send someone to tell me such a thing. How can it be? I'm troubled with it. I'm troubled because here's an angel with a message that he says that it's from God and it doesn't even make sense to me. I want to let you know something, that every time that God tells us to do something, it isn't going to make sense. When we sit there and try to figure out God, it will never make sense. If God says to do it and we think about it and we say it can't be done, you're probably right, it can't be done. And therefore, God is saying do it because he wants to receive the glory and honor. And so, all of a sudden, it doesn't make sense. His message is impossible. How can it be? How can it be that I'm going to be with child? It's impossible. I'm troubled with what this is doing. And then she starts thinking and saying, wait a minute. He's saying that God spoke to the angel to bring me this message. Why me? Who am I? I don't really deserve. I'm a young virgin woman. She has never been married, has never known a man, doesn't know one thing about marriage, has never taken marriage counseling. She doesn't know anything about anything. She just, all of a sudden, boom, you're going to be pregnant. That is confusing. That is troubling to her. You know, why would God find favor? Listen to me. Sometimes I've heard people say, well, I don't deserve this. And I tell them, you know what? You're right. You don't deserve it. I don't deserve what I have. I don't deserve where I'm at. I don't. But because of his grace, thank the Lord that he still believes in me, that he places me there for a purpose and a reason. He doesn't select us because we're somebody that is so special beyond everybody. He selects us because we're willing and because we want to and because we're open and saying, God, of all my mistakes that I've made in my past and all the things that I've done, you've overlooked them, but you see my heart and my desire that I want to do something. So with troubling brings fear and confusion. All of a sudden, she becomes fearful. Why? Because in verse 30, look what it says. In verse 30, look, it says, I was going to read in Spanish. I have a bilingual Bible. Praise the Lord. I was like, I got confused here. I said, the angel spoke Spanish. Amen. He says, But then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God." She became fearful. Why? She was troubled because of the fact that she was natural, and all of a sudden something supernatural was about to happen in her life. Let me tell you something. The way that God works is in the supernatural. We can never reach God in the natural. You can do everything that you can in the natural, and that will not reach to God. The only way we can reach God is through the supernatural. That's why prayer is so important. That's why when we pray and seek God, we get into the realm where He understands, and that's where the supernatural comes in. When the doctor says, or when somebody says that you are not able to do it, but the supernatural comes in and says it's going to happen, God brings a healing in their lives. It's supernatural. And so she's fearful and saying, "How can I, as a natural person, be involved in the supernatural? That's fearful." The other thing was the message. You're going to have a child. I'm fearful. I've never been a mom. I've never changed diapers. I don't know what it is to be a mom. I've never taken any classes to know anything like that. I'm just a young girl. The other thing she feared is the responsibility. Oh my gosh, God is about to give me His Son, and I am responsible to take care of God's Son. Now, it's one thing to take care of somebody else's child. You see? I mean, you know, when we used to have the daycare, when something happened to the child, if the child fell or the child got hurt, immediately I would get a letter, my wife would get a letter, And the daycare would get a letter from CPS wanting to investigate what happened. And that's scary enough when CPS calls and they want to know what happened to that child. Can you imagine if God called, you got a letter from God and saying, "I need to talk to you." And God didn't even talk to you. He sent an angel. It's, uh-oh. So she's fearful. What about the reputation? She's fearful of her reputation. She's a young girl, never been married, and all of a sudden she's going to be pregnant. What are the people going to say? I've got to tell my mom and my dad that I'm pregnant, and then I'm going to say, "But mom and dad, don't get mad. It's from the Holy Spirit. God did it." Estás loca. ¿Qué estás haciendo aquí? I mean, you all of a sudden, no, their reputation. What are people going to say? I know people don't talk. But in those days, they talked. I look at them. She comes to church and she, "Did you hear? She said she got pregnant by the Holy Spirit." Can you believe that? That is so absurd. I wonder what if I was Joseph, I'd leave her right now. If Joseph can't even trust her now, how much more now when they're going to get married? ¿Y cómo? ¿Y la suegra? Woo! Mother-in-law? Joseph, get over here. You're going to marry this woman? This woman? Have you been doing something that you shouldn't have been doing? Mom. The reputation. That's fearful. You see, when God calls us, the people that don't understand the spiritual will always talk about things because they look at it as the natural, but God is looking at it as the supernatural. And only the people that walk in the supernatural will understand that it is the spiritual things that are going to make it happen. And therefore, it's our responsibility to be in the spiritual. The Bible says she was confused. Verse 34. Look at verse 34. "How will this be," Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin?" I am confused here. I've never been with a man. I'm human. I'm a virgin. And all of a sudden you think you're going to say that I'm going to have a child. What is Joseph going to say? And God says, "You know, don't worry about Joseph. I'll take care of him." And God does. He's over there, and Joseph's trying to divorce her, trying to break it off. And God shows up and says, no, you need to take her as your wife because what she has conceived is of the Holy Spirit. Come on now. Now, I'm human. I'm confused here. I'm going to have a child supernaturally? How can that be? Supernatural things in the natural, how can it be? And I'm poor, yet you're telling me that he's going to reign over the house of Jacob. I have no money, I have nothing, and you're telling me he's going to be a king and rule over the house of Jacob? You're telling me that he's called the Son of the Most High? I have a big responsibility. I mean, I don't know, I'm confused because what if Jesus does something wrong and I discipline him and I spank him? Is God going to get mad? I don't know. Come here, I'm going to give you a good... I'm going to tell my dad. Go to timeout. Can you imagine the confusion that there was here? But here's the thing. Things begin to change when she hears something. In verse 37, it changes things. Because in verse 37, it says, for nothing is impossible with God. If God said he was going to do it, he's going to do it. Whether people say yes, whether people say no, whether the people talk, whether people don't talk, whatever happens, nothing is impossible for God. God will provide it any way that he wants. He will make it happen. And here's what happens. She takes the focus off herself and starts focusing on the message, on what God has said. See, here's the issue, is that we focus on ourselves thinking that we can't do it. It's impossible to do it. Oh, what are people going to say? And immediately when she hears the angel say, but nothing is impossible for God, she turns around, takes the focus away from her, and she says, it's him. I serve him. Now, because of the focus switch, she honored God, she served God, she loved God, she trusted God. And so here's what she says in verse 38. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. We will never allow him to do anything that he wants unless we recognize that I'm the servant and he's the master. See, here's the issue. We want him to be the servant, and we want to be the master. We want to tell God what to do. And we want to tell him to do it now. And our prayers is, God, you need to give. You need to give me that. I need that. And if you don't, I'm not going to do it. And that's the reason why she was afraid and troubled, because her focus was on herself. But when she turned it around and the focus was on God, she said, wait a minute. Things have to be here. If my master says this is what I've got to do, then I am his servant and I will do it. See, when we get an attitude of a servant, guess what? We'll be submissive and things will begin to happen. And we begin to realize that he's the one that we're serving. He's not serving us. We are serving him. And if he says for me to do it, I'm going to do it. Regardless what anybody else says, I'm going to fulfill it. And because he said this, she was able to say, may it be fulfilled. May it come true of what you have said. You see, because there are three things that she became submissive. And these are the three things. She found comfort and trust in who? On the one who sent the message. On the one who sent the messenger. In other words, I focus on God. If God brought the message and he thinks I can do it, which is very difficult for me, but if he thinks I can do it, let it be fulfilled in my life because I'm your servant. I trust who you are, God. I trust who you are. And she had comfort not only on the one who sent the message, but she had comfort and she had found comfort and trust in the messenger. He was from God. Gabriel. He was from heaven. And the last thing, she had comfort on the message that had been sent for her. One of the greatest things is this, for you to understand, that God wants to fulfill his plan in your life. You are not just here by coincidence. God has given you skills, abilities, talents. He's given you the person that you're with. He has given you a church. He's given you people around you so that you can fulfill what God has in your life. But a lot of times we take away the focus and think on other things. You see, there's a lot of people that believe, that really don't believe what Christmas is all about. They're confused with what Christmas is all about. I was watching the news the other day and came out on the news and they were saying about Linus, you know, the Charlie Brown, when he's looking for the answer of what really Christmas is all about. And it was saying in the news, he said, you know, years ago when they put this on the scene of the Peanut characters, there was something very difficult, because when they brought the message that Christmas was about Jesus, there was a little conflict of how you could share it for people because it could offend people. And then they were saying that even if they were to play it today, the atheists, the liberals, everybody would be in an uproar. But I want you to understand something. That Christmas is Jesus. And I want you to see this little, I don't know if many of you have seen it, but I want you to see this the way that it was presented. Would you show that for me?
Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?
Sure, Charlie Brown. I can tell you what Christmas is all about. Lights, please. And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God, and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
I had to show you a cartoon character to tell you what I wanted to say. Amen. Some of you understood it a lot better. But I want you to understand in reality that all of us have a purpose in life. Fulfill it. Fulfill it. It's not going to be easy. But if God is involved, there is a reason God will pull you through. I want you to bow your heads where you are. And I want you to think about your life. Not what you have accomplished that makes you better, but it's who you are in Christ that makes you better. You see, because you might have not accomplished a lot of things. Maybe you didn't finish school. Maybe you don't know how to read. Maybe you don't have a great paying job, and it's not so much the way the world sees it as that you have been successful. It's just like Mary. Mary had never experienced anything else than just being a young girl, and God had already big plans for her life. And it wasn't until she realized that she knew that she was a servant and not the master, that she was able to say, God, would you fulfill what you have said? Let it be fulfilled. The moment that she said that, the angel left. There was no trying to convince her. She had already convinced herself that she was ready to take that task. The gospel is for everyone. I don't know about your life today. You've come to this service this morning, maybe in a need of something, maybe empty, maybe you're seeking something, maybe you don't know what your purpose in life is. Maybe you don't realize, man, what I'm looking for a purpose in life. But today is the day that if you would just turn the focus on Him and not on you and say, I'm a servant, Lord, that you will begin to realize that God has called you for a purpose and you will know that purpose. Is there anyone here today that as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, if you would just say, Pastor, I need you to pray for me. I want to change. I want Jesus in my life. Is there anybody here before we dismiss that says, Lord, I pray for me, Pastor. I've never accepted Jesus. And maybe some of you that are watching through live stream or the internet or Facebook, you may be in that same situation. And I'm asking you too. It's so important that you realize that you also need God to change your life. Is there anybody here that says, Pastor, would you pray for me? I want to pray for you real quickly. Is there anybody here? Then I want to pray this general prayer, and then we will be done today. Father, I thank you for the opportunity that you give us to come and gather together. It wasn't easy for Mary to accept this challenge in her life. But you know what? It's not easy because all of us have a purpose to fulfill. But the beautiful thing about it is that you mentioned this to her and you said, God is with you. You spoke to her and said, God is with you, not to be fearful. For nothing is impossible for God. And God, I just pray right now that we realize that whatever task you've called us to do, we're going to fulfill it. God, we're gonna be challenged, but guess what? We're not going to fear it. For nothing is impossible. For we can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength. I pray that this Christmas, Lord, as people gather together tonight, maybe to eat for Christmas Eve, opening their gifts, or maybe tomorrow during Christmas, as they gather together with family, let us celebrate what Christmas is all about. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you for the greatest gift that we have been able to unravel in our hearts, and that's Jesus Christ. Thank you for the forgiveness of our sins. Thank you for the blood that was shed for us. Thank you for our salvation and our healing. Thank you for the joy and the peace. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the word of the Lord. Thank you for who you are. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. May you have a wonderful Christmas today. Oh, yes, before you go, before you have a Merry Christmas, have a seat. I think there's a giveaway. Would you have a seat real quickly? Would you take back the Merry Christmas for right now? I forgot all about this. You got a giveaway? Oh, yes. The purses that they were going to raffle off.
So as y'all know, we've been raffling off these purses. So we're going to do the drawing form right now. This one's going to be the.
This is for the Dream Center. You know, we're raising funds for the Dream Center. So, ladies, let's see who's going to be the lucky one today. And by the way, it does have money in it. So if you do win it, it's not real money, but it's money. I mean,
right,
fake
so
money.
So this is going to be for the black purse. All right.
I don't know.
That's a tongue twister right there. Yeah, it is.
Carolyn Pacina. No. It's Sister Chema, Anselma Giddings. She's not here today. So I know who she is. Are you going to give it to her?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so I know who she is.
Okay, and then this one will be for the one with the purple one with the handbag and the wallet. That's my mom, Deanne Rodriguez. All right, thank y'all. That's all we have.
Amen. God bless you, everyone. Have a Merry Christmas. And hey, don't forget next Sunday. Amen. God bless you.